Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
How are you today?
I'm great.
I hope you always have a great day.
Amin.
Let me introduce myself. My name is Akhina Sitaparasti Ihtiyarta with my partner
Rati Amelia.
Welcome to the Sweet Taste Talk Show.
So, did anyone knows what the topic is?
No.
The topic is about learning morphology in album Fearless by Taylor Swift. How far did you know about morphology?
Of course, I do know nothing. So that's why we invite the guest star that who knows so many things about morphology. You know who is he?
Of course I know. His name is Mr. Danny Sulaiman, who has teaching more than 252 classes from 2004 until now.
That's correct. Can we call him now?
Sure. So please welcome Mr. Danny Sulaiman.
Good to see you, sir. How are you doing today?
I am wonderful today. I like this evening.
Have a seat, please.
Okay, thank you.
We have some question for you, Mr. Daddy.
Okay, that's fine. What's this the question?
For those who don't know about morphology, can you tell us what is morphology in general?
Well, morphology consists of two morphemes. The first is morpheme and the second one is motif. And you know, it refers to the Greek terms, because in our English explanation, probably you will know the study of words will be words, but this is morphology because we are not studying words, we are studying about the morpheme. So morphology is the scientific study of morphemes, not words. Okay, in language as general.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And then why the songs can be the media of learning morphology? What about the other media?
Yeah, that's a good idea. You know, everybody across language, religion, society, culture, most people love song, right? Although he or she can sing a song, or he or she cannot sing a song, but they love song. So that's why I take this case for song, because most people like bad song. That's why for this media, I'm going to discuss the morphology through song.
Consists 13 songs. Mm. There are Fearless, 15, Love Story, Hey Stephen, White Horse, you're not sorry, the way I love you, forever and always, the best day, change, tell me why, breathe, and the last one is you belong with me. Well, sir, what we can see on the screen, there are more fans and other more.
Okay.
Can you explain more about both of them?
Well, yeah, this is a good idea for the slides. The first is morpheme. A morpheme is the smallest meaningful element of a language. So we can see the keyword here. The first is smallest. So this is the small parts. Smallest is the superlative. We cannot divide it into smaller part. This is smallest. And the second term would be meaning. So morpheme, because this is not morph, we have morph. Morph here is the written text, morph, and the morpheme is the meaning. So when you know in English, for example, shen, conclusion, and then establishment, man here, man, the morpheme man is morph. But the morpheme is meaning. Because you know, in language, we have to deliver meaning. The first is meaning. Meaning is morpheme, and morph is the actualization of the morpheme. Well, it cannot be broken down further into smaller parts. The speciality is that morpheme have meaning. So we emphasize the first is smallest, and the second one is meaning. That's morpheme. Then, in my right side, an allomorph. An allomorph is each alternative form of a morpheme. This could be a variation in sound or pronunciation or spelling, but never in function or meaning. It means that, take a look at an Indonesian example first. You know, we have the active verb in the verb of Bahasa Indonesia. For example, we have tulis, and then the active verb would be metulis. Then, as an Indonesian, we have the word menulis because of the pronunciation menulis. And then when we have the Indonesian word like gali, so we have megali. But as a native, we don't say it megali, but menggali. Then the last one would be cuci. In Indonesian word would be mencuci. But we as a native don't say mencuci, it is mencuci. So allomorph, this is an allomorph, is each alternative form, alternative. So the alternative would be men in mencuci, meng in menggali, and then men in menulis. So men, men and meng is the alternative. The meaning is the same. Men is the active form. Okay, that is morpheme.
Then for the next, well, we know that morphemes have two types. There are free and bound. Okay. Can you give us the example about each type?
Yes. Yeah. Teaching means we have to be repetitive, you know, because repetition make us understand. The first is free morpheme here, a free morpheme who has the ability to stand on its own without the support of another form. It means that a standalone in English like table, chair, happy, and then run, and then sleep. This is called by stand on its own. It has the meaning, sleep. When the word sleeping, the word sleeping consists of sleep and ing, so this ing cannot stand alone. Because what is ing? What does ing form? But sleeping, yeah, we can know the ing in the word of sleep. So that's why one morpheme cannot stand on its own and requires the assistance of another form. include prefix and suffix. Like what I said, eat and eating. We don't eat and we don't eating. But see, if we say in, what do you mean by in? But in eating, we know that is the active verb of eat.
Moves to the types of alarm mark. There are past tense and fuller and negative. What is the meaning among them?
Well, yeah, this is the type of alarm mark. Ladies and gentlemen, we know that morpheme emphasizes the meaning. So the meaning in English for example past tense, the meaning is the verb consists of the original meaning of verb and the past tense of the verb. So for example, if the word is washed, there are two meanings. The first is the active verb of washed, and the second meaning is it occurred in the past. There are two meanings. So here, the past tense of ed, it, probably this is the common thing, the common form for past tense. You know, the verb like ate, I ate yesterday. So it consists of two morphemes. The first is eat, and the second is past tense. And the past tense here not actualized by ed, right? Eat become ate. So I ate yesterday. Ate consists of two morphemes. The first is eat and the second is past tense. So this past tense is the morpheme. And the morph is ed. Probably the ate would be eat. It is the active participle. Eat and then ate. So the past tense here lies in pronunciation, not in the ed. Okay, let's see. Ed always has the same function, making the verb past, but is pronounced slightly different depending on the verb. For example, washed, then planted. Okay, so the morpheme is the meaning, and the actualization from the morpheme is the morph itself. Here ed, and then you know, from eat to be ate, from sleep to be slept. So sleep, slept. The word slept has two morphemes. The first is performing sleep, and the second is past tense. Does it make sense for you, ladies? Past tense? Okay. Should I continue to the plural?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Let's see, this is the plural alarm. Okay. Us or es is the common form for morphology. But you know, from child to be children. From child to be children. So the meaning is plural. And the actualization could be us or es or the other form. So you know, the word children consists of two morphemes. The first is a kid, and the second one is plural. This plural could be actualized by run, not only us or es. So child plus plural equals to children. Here book plus plural equals to books. Okay. So, woman is singular, women is plural. So the change from a woman, women. So the pronunciation change. So the word women consists of two morphemes. The first is woman, the second is plural. So us or es is the common form in morphology. Well, and then the negative one, it could be in or ill, yeah. Let's take a look at this example. The first is Lego. Okay, Lego negative become in Lego. But for native, like what I said in Bahasa Indonesia, in Lego is not native for English. So Lego plus negative form would be ill Lego, not in Lego, but ill Lego. And then regular. Regular become irregular, so not irregular. Because for native, for English native, regular, regular plus negative would be irregular. So the morpheme of in, im, or ir, or ill is the same meaning to negate the words, but the form is different. Sometimes in, ill, then ear, that is followed by almorph. This is the alternative form in morphology.
Wow, I don't know a lot of things.
Okay.
Now the time for the main topic, morphology analysis in Thurlow's album of Taylor Swift. The first one is in the song of You Belong With Me. In this song, which there are phrasal verbs, burn out and light up. Can you tell me why it can be a phrasal verb, Mr. Denny?
Okay. Well, thank you, Lady. Yeah, I think we know the title. This is from native. In our grammar, we are studying that belongs is with, you know, with what? Belong. It belongs to me too. But for native, belong with me. I think this is good for us to analyze. In probably morphology or semantic, this is a good idea to analyze why this is belong with, not belongs to. Probably when you were in Sanyo High School, you know that according to, based on, belong to, but this is you belong with me. So we have to consider what is the meaning of with here, with the word of belong, because this is not common. Like, you know, in the song of Beatles, in our grammar, we are studying she doesn't, but sometimes in Beatles, he don't, she don't. You know that don't is for I, me, you, they don't, but this is she or he don't. I think this is a good idea for you to analyze. And then your question is worn out and light up, because this is the verb. You know, light as a noun. Actually, light is a noun. There is a light here. But because that could, light. After could, it must be the infinitive. After could. So this is the verb. And up here, this is called by preposition. So this is called by phrasal verb. The verb that combine with this preposition, and this is become the verb that has the other meaning, you know, like angry with, belong with, belong to. We have the preposition after the verb that is called by phrasal verb, worn out, like that. But for you to analyze, in English we have this dash, worn out with dash, and light up without dash. Yeah, there is another categorization in morphology.
Alright, sir.
Mm-hmm.
For the second analysis, in song 15, there are words noted in pride as positive or more. Can you tell more about them instead?
Well, yeah, when all you wanted was to be wanted, and we both cried. Yeah. Wanted and cried. I think, yeah. To be wanted probably we know this is in here to be wanted, and we both cried. This is at 2B, so this ED categorized into past participle, because after 2B, past participle. In Indonesian learning, probably you know verb 3, but this is in English, you know there is no verb 1, verb 2, verb 3. But when you learn in English, when you work in Seno High School, Junior High School, probably you know verb 1, verb 2, verb 3. But in English, we have infinitive, past tense or past form, and past participle. Because this is to be past participle. And here, and we both write. After the subject, we here. So this write is a verb. So it must be the past tense, and this is past participle. All you wanted, all you as a subject wanted is a verb. To be wanted is past participle, and this is the verb. So wanted and write is the same thing as a verb, and this is the past participle.
Next, for the third, analysis. In a song of grief, there are minds and start as a plural aloma. So how the explanation about that, sir?
Yeah, lady, it could be plural and what is it? Third singular. You know, we have many form of us. Here we change our minds. Yeah, our minds. Mind as a noun, and then us here. That is right to make the mind to be plural, but not for this one. Music starts. Start is a verb. So the us here, not to make the start to be plural, but the function of us here is to show that the subject is he, she, or it. So this us refers to the third singular. Like she goes, yeah, because this is verb. So us here to show that the subject is she. Different from this us. So we have two form of us. The first, when this us attached to the noun, mind, this us shows the plurality. But when this us attached to the verb, it shows that this is to show the verb, the third singular. I mean, the subject is he, she, or it. Music starts. Okay?
From the soul,
I really love you.
The word undone, translated
over
form. Can you give the reason why it can be like?
Well, I'm breaking down and coming undone. Yeah. There are many ways how to negate the English words. Like the previous one, we have in, ill, or ear. We have this, in, dislike, and disagree. So that this is one of them, and is to negate the word done. We know in English undo, in computer, in your laptop, undo. If you want to reverse your action, you can just undo. But this is undone. So undone, the negative form in past participle, undone. Undone means, this is not undo. We have undo in English. In your laptop, you know undo, redo. But this is the negative for the past participle, undone. Like unforgettable. Unforgettable in Bahasa Indonesia, we have the translation tak bisa dilupakan, tak terlupakan. Terlupakan means this is past participle.
Wow, we have been discussed a lot of morphology and stuff. Thank you very much for your time, Mr. Lady.
Okay.
And I think our guest with a lot of knowledge today. Once again, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, finally, it brings us to the end of this talk show.
Yeah, finally, we got to know a lot more Polish.
Yeah, but we have to end up our talk show.
But let me say, because after this, there are musical performance, they will sing a Taylor Swift song titled Love Story.
Ladies and gentlemen, stay tuned and thank you for the attention.
And we are sorry for the imperfection.
I'm Safina Sitaparas Indiata and my partner
Rantia Amelia. We say goodbye.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
But if you